Hi, so it's Lucas from Bucks, and I'm delighted to be joined on the line by Kieran Gaffney. How are you doing, Kieran?
How are you, mate? I'm great.
I'm great, thank you. Yeah, so I do feel this conversation is long overdue, and I'm delighted to be able to have the opportunity to speak to you at the minute.
Yeah, no problem.
Fantastic. So yeah, I just wanted to, if I could get the inside of you on your recent appearance, on the Golden Contract, the super lightweight. Golden Contract that was, of course, from MTK Global and broadcast live on Sky Sports. I think logically, if we go back to, the initial announcement that you was going to be a part of the reserve bout with Mikey Sacker.
Well, when I found out, it always felt like that's where my focus was going to be aiming. First off, I was boxing in Cardiff on the same date, so I was aiming for that. But it'd be like a low level journeyman on the end of the card of that, and then about 4 weeks out, I get the call saying I'm going to be fighting Saki on the end of the card. And that fight just never seemed real. It just didn't seem like that was what was gonna happen. I don't know why it's a funny thing to think, but it always felt like I was gonna be up in the main tournament.
Okay, so I suppose having that mindset, kept you on your toes, with the belief that as you say, you would eventually be part of the main tournament, which due to withdrawal from your Turov, seeing both you and Mikey Sacker moved up. What was your thought process when you had made part of the official Golden Contract tournament?
Probably I felt like that's where I think I should be. I definitely think my career is heading that way, to be a regular on nights like that. And yeah, it just felt like being a part, it felt to me like being a part of that was where I was supposed to be.
Fantastic. It's good to hear, that kind of confidence and self-belief, which is a massive thing, I guess, is as somebody only looking in on a boxer's mindset. But self-belief and confidence has got to be right up there as necessities as part of a makeup of a boxer.
Yeah, definitely. You just gotta always be confident. Always, if you think you're gonna go far, you probably are. And I think I'm gonna go very far, so hopefully I get it.
Yeah, fantastic. Looking at the live draw, which adds to the drama of the Golden Contract tournament, I think this is why it's captured the imagination of the boxing public. So at the draw, you're able to pick your opponent, your first choice, and obviously at the time, Lewis Benson was part of the tournament, and you chose Lewis. At the time, obviously I know things played out differently, but can you just quickly take us through your thought process? You have these four men in front of you. What was your reasoning for choosing Lewis Benson at that point?
I'd sort of been looking for a fight with Lewis for a while. Me and him had even talked about it over Twitter. Talked about having a fight if we could get the right title on or something like that. But I'd always felt again like that's who I was wanted to pick. That's who I wanted to fight. When I first seen the lineup, I thought he'd be the perfect fight for me at this stage of my career, and I do honestly think he would have been. And Jeff was a tough guy, but a completely different cookie to what I picked out of the packet,
Yeah, definitely. So, moving on there, as you touched on, drama right up until fight night, from
was drama for you guys, it was a piss off for me.
yeah, I could only imagine. So, Lewis Benson, unfortunately for him, is withdrew from the fight at, I can't even say the 11th hour, it was even later than that. And he's replaced by Jeff Lefora. Who himself had only boxed a matter of, days, weeks before in Liverpool. So he's a last minute replacement. Can you, give us the inside view of what's going through your mind at that point? It's already a hectic schedule, hectic layout to a tournament, and then there's this final obstacle to overcome.
It didn't even concern me at all at the start. It was as it got closer and closer to the actual fight. That's when I thought, oh, I've been training for all these different things, and his style wasn't one of them. But it's so many new experiences for me. I've been on, you know, I've been the headline on some smaller TV shows on SOC and stuff, but it was the first thing at this scale I've ever been involved with, you know, even down to the press week. It was a lot of it new to me, all in one go, you know what I mean? And I think I handled myself well there, you know, I didn't make myself look an idiot, and I felt confident all the way through it, so that was good. But like I say, like you said, it was a hectic week already, and that added to the chaos.
Yeah, I think, you know, I'd like to add there, you know, I did keep up with a lot of the the fight week previews and build up, you know. I do think, you know, you did conduct yourself, you know, admirable, you know, throughout, and you know, leading up to the fight, which is what I'm going to touch on next. Yeah, I think you know, your way you came across, the way you carried yourself was, yeah, you know, full of confidence. Yeah, I think you came across really well.
Good, because that's the image I want to portray, and I want people to see me and think of me as a real good professional, a model professional, you know. And I think you've got to conduct yourself outside the ring as professionally as you do inside it.
Definitely, you know. So if we can just move on to the actual fight itself, can we get your breakdown and take us through the fight from your perspective? You know, I'm guessing you've watched the fight back.
I watched the fight back. I waited a while to watch it because I was still a bit angry about the decision. But I felt like the rounds that he won were ones where he had a quick burst, and that was basically it. You know, he'd obviously land more solid shots because he was swinging them from so much further, you know, and all those dark angles. But I just thought I outboxed him myself. Maybe the fourth and the sixth were clear rounds to him. Aside from them, I'd say most of them were me outboxing him. So I can understand why the referees came up with the draw. Well, the judges came up to the draw, but to have a referee who was, you know, pretty on my case from the start, really, even the commentator team commented on how fiercely he was warning me and stuff, you know. So that side of the contest, I didn't feel very well. But you look at the stats and everything, it's my punch count's higher. I'm throwing more punches every round, and at the end, I landed more punches and still ended up losing the fight. So, you know, this is one of those awkward ones.
I think, you know, the tournament effect, you know, the way it needed the fourth card to ensure, obviously, someone moved on in the tournament. You know, again, it's great for the paying viewer and the boxing fan, but again, someone in your shoes where, you know, you believed you won the fight, I can imagine that being, as you mentioned, just great.
It wouldn't even matter if he had evidence it with the scorecard, you know, a numbered scorecard, but he doesn't, to my understanding.
Yeah.
He's just whoever he thinks wins, and, you know, he's a London ref, a London boy. I don't know the relationship or whatever, but Kieran McCann had refereed me once previously and gave me a controversial loss then, with my first loss over a four-rounder, and I believe he's done it again over an eight for me.
You know, we're talking here like about, you know, your perspective of watching the fight back. What was your thoughts, you know, at that final bell? You know, what was your instant reaction at the final bell? Do you believe you've done enough?
Yeah, you watch it and my hands up before it is. I'm going around, I'm thanking the crowd, you know, doing a little bow or whatever to each side of the ring, and it's me just smiling all the way through. And if you watch the video, in fact, my hand is up until the last referee, the last judge's call. And then as soon as he announces the referee makes a decision, my face drops. So due to my body language, I think you can see how I felt that the contest went.
Yeah, I think, you know, it was definitely evident, you know, that you, as you mentioned, right up until that final, you know, and decisive referee scorecard. You know, your body language told the story of what you believed was about to happen. You know, you believed you'd won the fight, you know.
Yeah, it's just the pisser that the biggest night of my career publicly didn't end up with me getting my hand raised. But it's only a draw. I've still got another opportunity to prove myself, so that's what I got to look at next.
Yeah, fantastic. That leads nicely on to the final two things that I want to speak about. You know, firstly, I think we'll start off with looking at the Golden Contract Tournament. Can I get your thoughts and your predictions on how you think the rest of the tournament will play out? You know, were you impressed by anybody that boxed on the night? You know, any standout performer, anyone that you will win the tournament now you're not a part of it?
For me, I think we're all very much on an even keel, bar Mimoue. I think he brings something a bit more unique. But down pure boxing, I think anyone could have beaten anyone in that round, in that first round, sorry. So for me, Mimoue is probably the favourite now. But you can't deny someone like Davis hitting hard or Tyrone's ferocity through the rounds, you know.
Yeah.
I think they have big parts to play.
Fantastic. And finally, you know, we're coming towards the end of 2019, of course, and we're soon moving into 2020. What does the new year hold in store for Kieran Geffen, do you believe? Where do you go from there?
I believe the quarter finalists of the tournament all fight each other, so I've still got the opportunity to fight someone like Logan Yoon, who's a top 100 world ranking. I'll beat him, and you know, you can imagine the position I'd be in. And yeah, just another opportunity on a big platform, Sky and ESPN. And then after that, I'd like to look at picking up another title.
Fantastic. So, you know, what you mentioned there, you know, the losing quarter finalists will box each other. Will that be part of the next instalment of the Golden Contract? So, you know, when the semi finals are on, you'll be on.
Yeah. We'll basically, I imagine you call it the undercard to the semi finalists then.
Fantastic. That'd be really interesting to see, you know, because it might give a bit of an insight to if the draw had been different, how things.
Yeah, definitely. Fantastic idea. Like I say, it provides a lot of opportunity. People like myself who lost out on a poor decision, and, you know, all the best to Jeff. But he said to me straight after the fight he wanted to give me a rematch, so maybe that's something you'll see next year too.
Yeah, that'd be really interesting to see. You know, once you see how the tournament plays out, I can only speak for myself, but I think that'd be a really interesting rematch to see, you know, to see you guys go at it again.
Good.
Yeah,
you never know if someone drops out.
Yeah, that's it. But yeah, Kieran, I'd like to thank you for your time. You know, it was a fascinating listen to hear, like I say, from the inside of such a brilliant tournament, but a chaotic tournament. And, you know, thank you for your time. Really appreciate it.
Cheers, Luke. Thank you very much, mate.
Thank you very much, mate. Take care.